Hello, welcome to LMU Tri-State News. I'm Ashley Hurley. Thank you for joining us. The Charles Holland Alumnus of the Year Award was recently presented to this year's recipient by Lincoln Memorial University President B. James Dawson. Jared Effler of Maynardville was recognized during the homecoming alumni banquet for personifying the qualities and character of Abraham Lincoln. The award goes to a person who has achieved recognition in his or her professional life and who is an ambassador of goodwill and active in alumni activities. Effler graduated from LMU in 1995 and was recently elected the District Attorney General for the 8th Judicial District, covering Claiborne, Campbell, Fentress, Scott, and Union counties. Following graduation at LMU, he earned his Juris Doctorate from the University of Memphis School of Law and graduated with honors in 1999. Following law school, Effler was appointed Assistant District Attorney General for the 8th Judicial District, and he was elected and sworn in as District Attorney General in August of this year. Effler has remained close to his alma mater, serving as an adjunct professor in the Criminal Justice and Criminology program since 2005. Effler and his wife Mary reside in Maynardville, and they are the parents to daughters Katie Beth and Mia. The annual R. Gerald McCurtry Lecture recently featured Clemson University's Dr. Vernon Burton. The lecture is presented by the Abraham Lincoln Institute for the Study of Leadership and Public Policy and the LMU Duncan School of Law. The lecture, entitled The Emancipation Proclamation to the March on Washington, examined the Emancipation Proclamation and the controversy that still surrounds it. One of the questions that Burton addressed was, was it for justice or was it a desperate wartime measure? He argued that while Lincoln believed that the Emancipation Proclamation was the central act of administration, it was Lincoln's understanding of liberty that became the greatest legacy of the age. Burton is a recognized expert on race relations in the American South and a leader in digital humanities. He is often invited to present lectures, conduct workshops, and consult with colleges and universities and also granting agencies. The stories we tell, the burdens we wear, that is this year's slogan, as well as a strong reminder for domestic violence awareness. Through this Friday, you can join others on the quad to make a t-shirt to display through the week in dedication of domestic violence awareness. There is a color code for specific attacks regarding different types of domestic violence. The colors that will be presented are white, black, green, gold, pink, red, and blue. On your screen, you can see what each of those colors represents to determine what color shirt you can decorate. If you are worried about remaining anonymous, you can take and decorate a shirt and or drop it off at Avery Hall. A candlelight vigil will be held on the quad at 6:30 this Thursday night. If anyone is interested in speaking publicly about your experience, you may contact Amy Spurlock at 423-869-6014. Next Tuesday, the polls will be open for election all across the United States, and that includes right here at home. There are several local elections taking place, so let's take a quick look at those. Running for United States House of Representatives in the Congressional District, we have John J. Duncan Jr., Bob Scott, Norris Dreyer, and Casey Adam Gouge. In the Representative District, we have Jerry Sexton. Aldermen for the town of Cumberland Gap, Chuck Coffey, Jerry M. Hobson, and John Ravnum. Aldermen for the town of Cumberland Gap to fill an unexpired term, J. Michael Claiborne and Teresa Lynn Fusen. For mayor in the town of Harrogate, Bill Fultz and Troy R. Poor. Aldermen for Harrogate include Alan Hurst. Alderman for the ward in Ward 1 in the town of New Tazewell is Stanley H. Leonard and Kendall L. Walker. For Ward 2, Charles Brooks and Franklin Essery. For Ward 3, Charles Doc DeBusk. For aldermen in the town of Tazewell, all are running unopposed, and they are for Ward 1, Riley DeBusk, Ward 2, Patrick Hurley, Ward 3, Betsy Schaffner. Also on the ballot for the town of Tazewell, a vote for or against the legal sale of alcoholic beverages for consumption on the premises in the city of Tazewell. In the state of Tennessee, we will also be voting on Amendment 1, 2, 3, and 4. Those amendments will be covering abortion, a state income tax, judicial retention, and allowing veteran organizations to hold raffles raffles for fundraisers once a year. So be sure to head out to the polls on Tuesday and make your vote count. Now, coming up after the break, we will be bringing you a very touching and personal story from one of our own coworkers who sits down with her mother, a breast cancer survivor, in honor of Breast Cancer Awareness Month. We have that story and more right after the break.
Hart, what's going on?
I'm leaving.
Why? What did I do?
Not enough. You constantly ignore me. You barely eat anything healthy. You're half as active as you used to be. The pressure is just too much. I quit.
Okay, I get it. I'll do better. Just please, don't leave.
Okay, but remember, if I go, you go.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. Uncontrolled high blood pressure could lead to stroke, heart attack, or death. Get yours to a healthy range before it's too late.
Get your ass out. You're not sitting here.
Yes, I am. No, no, no.
Every day, kids witness bullying.
Why are you stabbing me with it?
No.
They want to help, but don't know how. Teach your kids how to be more than a bystander. Visit stopbullying.gov.
As we close out another Breast Cancer Awareness Month, one of our very own employees here at LMU-TV brings you a very personal and in-depth story on the battle with breast cancer and what it means to be a survivor. To tell that story, here is Rachel Maddie.
You've mentioned it's Breast Cancer Awareness Month, but this time last year that meant a little more to you.
It did. I went in October of 2013 to the Knoxville Comprehensive Breast Center for my annual mammogram, and they found a tumor. I had the annual mammogram in 2012, and the testing had not shown anything. And so in one afternoon, I had the mammogram, ultrasound, biopsies, and clips in to mark the tumor.
I was in a state of shock, but I think we all were to some extent. What else was going through your mind when that started?
It was just such a blur. I really didn't have time to process everything, I don't think, because things were moving so fast. I had been diagnosed with triple negative breast cancer, and it was fast growing and it was aggressive. And so in the following 2.5 weeks, I had bone scans, CAT scans, I had heart testing, I had appointments with the oncologist, with the surgeons, and then I had to have port placement for the chemotherapy. And right after that, I had a sentinel lymph node biopsy, and it also tested positive for cancer. And by November 12th, I was in chemotherapy treatment.
How did you decide where to seek treatment?
I was really fortunate in that at Knoxville Comprehensive Breast Center, everything is located in the one facility. And so my surgeon was there, and they then recommended an oncologist through the Tennessee Cancer Specialist. And that's where I saw the doctors there. I also took time and met with my family physician of 30 years who is at UT Medical Center. We had a very long consult. I valued his opinions and his wisdom. And then my family really kicked it into gear, as you well know, and we began researching a lot of very credible sites for universities, research facilities, and credible organizations for information, keeping in mind that there are different types of breast cancer. There are different levels of treatment, different intensity of treatment as well, and individuals respond differently.
Those are all some important points and great suggestions. What would be some other suggestions you would give people?
Well, as I said, use credible websites for your searching, such as American Cancer Society, Livestrong, Komen, Mayo, MD Anderson, universities, hospitals. Use credible websites in searching, and I think it's really important for you to have a positive attitude. And so I didn't go to or read a lot of negative blogs or chats or stories. That can be really discouraging and very depressing, and I think for the patient, that's something to kind of steer away from during that time.
Thankfully, you had a complete response to the chemotherapy, that you received. You'll still be monitored for about 5 years.
I had less than a 20% chance of having a complete response, but I did, and I'm very blessed. And I have to say, I am the poster child for having annual mammograms for women young and old doing monthly self-exams. I think don't postpone it, don't put it off, don't skip it, no excuses. It doesn't hurt, mammograms are quick, and it can really save your life. I think that if I had decided to postpone or skip my mammogram, my quality and quantity of life would not be very great right now because of how aggressive my cancer was. So thankfully, I have a fighting chance at life now.
Now we are going to turn to Adam Haley. There's some sports that are coming to an end right now.
High school football, only 2 weeks left to go. It's coming down to the nitty-gritty. When you get to November, it's postseason time.
All right.
We've got that as well as volleyball and LMU soccer. That's what we're going to talk about when we return here on LMU Tri-State News.
Brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Welcome back. Let's start with LMU soccer, where both the men's and the women's teams were on the road in Salisbury, North Carolina for a South Atlantic Conference battle with Catawba College. We'll start with the women's matchup, where both teams coming in were looking for a victory to help their tournament causes. Both teams came out starting the filling out process as there was only 6 shots taken in the first half, but one of those shots was by LMU's Fernando Miachi, and it found the back of the net in the 37th minute to give the ladies the 1-0 lead that would last through halftime and into the second half. That was until Catawba's Kirsten Peck scored in the 66th minute off an assist from Karen Presnell to tie the game at 1. The score would be tied through the end of regulation and eventually through 2 overtime periods, and the Lady Rail Splitters and the Indians would have to settle for the 1-1 tie. LMU is now 9-2-2 on the season and 7-1-2 in conference play. In the men's game, both LMU and Catawba came out firing, with each team ending the first half with 5 shots apiece, but none would hit the back of the net, and the two teams went to the break scoreless. In the second half, once again, the two teams would have the same number of shots in the period, but finally a team took the lead on the scoreboard, and unfortunately for Rail Splitter fans, it wasn't the blue and gray. Catawba's Declan Stimson scored in the 65th minute to give the Indians the 1-0 lead they would hold all the way to the victory. With the loss, LMU falls to 7-4-3 overall and 4-3-3 in conference play. Both soccer teams will be in action this week as they travel to Nashville, Tennessee on Tuesday for a doubleheader against Trevecca Nazarene, and then they finish off the season at Wingate on November 1st. The LMU volleyball team coming into the weekend was getting used to having to battle for every point, as their last 3 games before last Friday had went 5 sets. Friday night, they played host to Lenoir Ryan University, and the ladies were looking to avenge their earlier 3-0 loss to the Bears. Both teams came out slugging, but it was LR who got control of set 1 around the 18th point before they took set 1 25-20. The Lady Rail Splitters would battle back to take set 2 25-18 and set 3 25-22. With their backs against the wall, the Bears would attack and fight back to take set 4 25-20 and eventually set 5 15-13 to win 3-2. Kira Holland finished with 18 kills, while Abby Cash and Casey Mincy combined for 43 digs. On Saturday, the Lady Rail Splitters were back in the Mars Gym for battle with Brevard College. Early on, it looked like LMU would roll, but the Tornadoes were looking for a win and would battle hard to find one. LMU took set 1 25-14 before dropping set 2 25-21. With the teams tied at 1 set, LMU knew the time for the knockout blow was upon them, and that's what they eventually delivered, that punching, winning set 3 25-21 and set 4 25-16 to take the match 3-1. After the weekend, LMU is now 15-10 overall and 11-6 in the South Atlantic Conference. LMU will spend the upcoming weekend on the road at 7th-ranked Wingate Halloween night and at Coker on November 1st. Now, there are only 2 weeks left until the high school football playoffs start. And with that, let's take a look at scores from last Friday night. It was Pigeon Forge knocking down Claiborne 58-12. Scott shut out Cumberland Gap 42-0. It was Cloudland knocking off Hancock County 42-14. In Southeast Kentucky, Bell County rolled McCreary Central 59-6. Middlesbrough got back on the winning track, beating Somerset 52-47. And Hazard defeated Pineville 42-6. Now, I want to let you know a lot of high school football this week will be on Thursday night due to Halloween, it is. Our high school game of the week will be Claiborne at Granger, and you see the rest of the list there, including Cumberland Gap, Hancock County, Union County, Campbell County, Bell County, and Middlesbrough. Matter of fact, Pineville is the only team that will play on Halloween night in the Tri-State area. That's going to do it for sports, but when we return, you'll have the entertainment report here on LMU Tri-State News.
This is the moment I knew. His future had no boundaries.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org.
Hi, Mom.
Dear.
Did you take your medicine?
Oh, gosh, I forgot it.
Her nurse.
You need a claim number?
Her personal assistant.
Let me just grab a...
Her housekeeper. Her cook. Her accountant. When I started taking care of Mom, I didn't realize the challenge of playing so many roles. But above all, I'm still her daughter.
Visit aarp.org/caregiving to connect with experts and other caregivers. Together, we can better care for ourselves and the ones we love.
Further honoring the month of the all things spooky, our useless trivia question takes us to the movie franchise Halloween. Whose face is the mask in the Halloween movies based off? Think hard and we'll give you the answer later in the segment. In entertainment news, the iconic designer Oscar De La Renta passed away at the age of 82 in his home in Kent, Connecticut. He is known for his stunning designs that have graced numerous red carpets and influential events throughout his 50-year career. The designer cause of death is still unclear. However, complications may have arisen after he was diagnosed and survived cancer in 2006. Native to the Dominican Republic, De La Renta moved to study painting at the Royal Academy of Fine Arts of San Fernando in Madrid. His first job was in 1950, where he worked in the Madrid salon of Costabal Balencia. His job was taken to sketch dresses to send to clients. Francesca Lodge, the wife of John Davis Lodge, then the United States ambassador to Spain, commissioned one of his first dresses for the debut of her daughter, Beatrice Lodge. The dress landed on the cover of Life magazine. After working for Levine by Antonio del Castillo, Elizabeth Arden and 7th Avenue, De La Renta started designing his own line in the late 1960s. Since then, he has created an empire and become a household name. He has dressed four first ladies, a multitude of celebrities, and recently Emil Amudin's wedding dress to wed George Clooney. The fashion world has lost a truly remarkable talent. James Corden is officially the new host of The Late Late Show. Corden will replace Craig Ferguson on the program beginning in March 2015. The show will tape in Los Angeles with Ben Winston serving as the executive producer, CBS announced on October 23rd. I can't describe how thrilled and honored I am to be taking over from the brilliant Craig Ferguson, Corden said in a statement when he was announced as host. To be asked to host such a prestigious show on America's number one network is hugely exciting. I can't wait to get started and will do my very best to make a show America will enjoy. If you're wondering where else you've seen James Corden, it was probably alongside Mark Ruffalo and Keira Knightley in Begin Again. You can also expect to see him star opposite of Meryl Streep and Anna Kendrick in Into the Woods this December. The first showing of The Late Late Show with James Corden will air on Monday, March 9th. The campy TLC show Here Comes Honey Boo Boo has been canceled. After reports of Mama June dating a convicted child molester surfaced, the show was put on the chopping block. TLC has canceled the series Here Comes Honey Boo Boo and ended all activities around the series effective immediately, supporting the health and welfare of these remarkable children is our only priority. TLC is faithfully committed to the children's ongoing comfort and well-being, the network said in a statement. The rumored boyfriend, Mark McDaniel, was convicted of aggravated child molestation in 2004. McDaniel served 10 years in a Georgia state prison and was released in March of this year and is currently a registered sex offender in Georgia. However, Mama June denies all claims. In a statement, she said, "Just got a phone call this morning from TLC, and as of right now, there will be no more production of the show. The statement of me dating a sex offender is totally untrue. Pumpkin has openly said that I did not, that I am not dating him, and also his son. I would not ever, ever, ever put my kids in danger. I love my kids too much. That is my past. I have not seen that person in 10 years and don't seem to want to see that person. We'll have to say goodbye to the child star, Honey Boo Boo." Queen Elizabeth has made history once again by sending her first tweet, marking the first social media message posted on behalf of the reigning British monarch. The 88-year-old queen was photographed touching an iPad on a display table at the Science Museum in London during an information technology gallery opening. The tweet reads, "It is a pleasure to open the Information Age exhibition today at the Science Museum, and I hope people will enjoy visiting Elizabeth R." Since then, the tweet has been retweeted over 40,000 times. The British monarchy account was opened in 2009 to share news about the royal family and has until Friday only been accessed by palace officials. The page has more than 850,000 followers, a number that is rising swiftly due to the Queen's tweet. Now stay tuned later. Joseph Lewis and Monique Derico will tell you what's going on in movies and local entertainment.
So who's going to do what?
I'll pack the dead batteries.
Great.
I'll only put what I don't need into a duffel bag.
Perfect. That's totally unhelpful.
No problem.
Meanwhile, I will try to comfort everyone by speaking in a calm voice.
And who is going to handle supplies?
I can forget to do a list for us.
Thanks, pal.
We couldn't be any less prepared. I'm proud of you guys.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Hello, I'm Joseph Lewis, bringing you all the latest information in the world of movies. Tops at the box office last weekend included the supernatural horror film Ouija, opening with $20 million and cementing this month as Hollywood's most profitable October of all time. Following at number two was the revenge-fueled actioner John Wick, starting its run with $14 million and continuing to generate positive word of mouth. And rounding out the top three was last week's winner Fury, raking in another $13 million and bringing its total domestic gross to $46 million, which means that the film still has a way to go toward recouping its $68 million budget. Coming to theaters this week is Nightcrawler, a thriller starring a gaunt, crazy-eyed Jake Gyllenhaal as Lou Bloom, an ambitious up-and-comer who infiltrates the seedy underground world of freelance crime journalism in Los Angeles. From exploiting real crimes and emergencies to staging fake ones for the benefit of his career, Lou adopts a dog-eat-dog life that proves destructive for both himself and everyone around him. Written and helmed by first-time director Dan Gilroy and featuring names like Rene Russo and Bill Paxton in the supporting cast, Nightcrawler has been getting nonstop buzz since its Toronto premiere in September and should definitely be one to keep an eye on as awards season heats up. Nightcrawler opens this Friday, October 31st. Also opening this week is Before I Go to Sleep, a film adaptation of S.J. Watson's best-selling mystery novel of the same name. Nicole Kidman stars as Christine Lucas, a woman who one day wakes up in an unfamiliar house with a man she doesn't know. As Christine begins to question her situation, she discovers that her lack of memory is the result of a traumatic accident, and from there, considerably more disturbing truths are uncovered. Colin Firth co-stars as her is-he-or-isn't-he husband, and Mark Strong portrays her doctor. Before I Go to Sleep was written for the screen and directed by Rowan Joffe, the screenwriter behind The American and 28 Weeks Later, and the film can be seen in theaters this Friday. This Halloween week also coincides with the 10th anniversary of the modern horror favorite Saw, and to commemorate the occasion, Lionsgate will be re-releasing the film in theaters across America for 1 week only starting this Friday. Although this grueling, blood-spattered exercise in terror paved the way for 6 sequels, the intimate, small-scale first film easily remains the best entry into the franchise. 2 men are chained up in a bathroom, a methodical and meticulous serial killer is hard at work, and a world-weary detective is on the case. And from there, well, as everybody knows, these movies aren't for the squeamish. Saw's grisly thrills can be relived on the big screen starting this Friday, October 31st, and some Thursday night showings may be available depending on your area. That's all for this week in the world of movies. I'm Joseph Lewis, and we'll be back after these messages.
For those dealing with the daily struggles of caring for a loved one, we hear you. That's why AARP created a community with experts and other caregivers to help us better care for ourselves and the ones we love.
In local entertainment, at any of this week's local events, I'm sure you will smell warm cider and pumpkin in the air as fall gets into full swing, not to mention the array of colors that surrounds us. If you're loving the fall colors, it only gets better from here. Claiborne County has many sights to offer, but if you're looking for a weekend getaway or a drive and still want to see those beautiful leaves, then head to the Great Smoky Mountains. Autumn colors in the Smokies is underway as we are midway through the peak season for fall colors. The colors will only intensify as they move from the peaks down the mountainsides in the upcoming weeks. The event runs through November 15th in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. There are plenty of Halloween festivities taking place all around. And on October 29th, Halloween Haunts and Haints is happening in Knoxville, Tennessee. The event features trick-or-treating, face painting, and children's crafts activities. The list goes on to include food and drinks, ghost stories, a costume parade, as well as a costume contest. There is a small admission fee for different age groups. And if you're looking to attend this festive event, visit marblesprings.net. The fall and Halloween fun is all around, and the Oaks Farm is at it again with their spectacular corn mazes. This year's maze promotes Tennessee's Department of Agriculture's program, Pick Tennessee. Participants have 1 to 1.5 hours to complete the maze. Your adventure requires you to locate 12 different posts, then find your way out. There are different mazes to choose from, including the Trail of Doom. To plan your trip and find out what other attractions are available, visit oaksfarm.com. Of course, those aren't all the places to visit this week. If you have any suggestions, please contact us on our Facebook page, LMU-TV. Going back to our useless trivia question, have you figured out whose face the mask worn in Halloween movies is based on? The person is William Shatner. Not only is it his face, but it is a Captain Kirk death mask created for Star Trek. I'm Monique Derico, and get out and enjoy the fall season.
And that is going to do it for this week's LMU Tri-State News. To close us out, here is a look at LMU's recent Vet Tech Dog Show. Thank you for joining us. For everyone behind the scenes, I'm Ashley Hurley.
And I'm Tiffany.